Good morning. My name is Bill Ariza. I'm a professor of law here and the vice dean. And on behalf of our faculty, students, and the editors of the Law Review, I'm delighted to welcome you to Brooklyn Law School. The Trager Symposium is a special event at the school. Not only does it celebrate a distinguished former dean and colleague, the Honorable David Trager, but it also furthers a core mission that has guided our school in its first 100 years, which is legal work and scholarship in the public interest. This is also a special day for a slightly different reason, and I'm going to go off script just for 1 second. The organizer of this conference, Professor Greg Macy, was voted tenure last night. And we are delighted to welcome him to the tenured faculty and wish him a long and productive career here. This year, we welcome a unique mix of scholars to the Trager Symposium. They work in various disciplines, including environmental sociology and energy and environmental law, science and technology studies, and public policy. The aim is not merely to showcase the range of perspectives these scholars bring to the green energy transition, but to invite collaboration across those disciplines, to point to similarities of method, and to consider how the research questions that we ask could be advanced through a richer sense of legal frameworks, social movements, and technological systems. We'll hear a variety of research projects before joining a roundtable discussion at the end of the day to see what we've learned from each other. We'll be introduced to a number of challenging questions. In what ways is the law of energy and how it addresses matters of federalism, pricing, the size and scale of environmental impacts and siting, in what ways is the law of energy prone to path dependence? What explains the limited success of tradable carbon emissions permits both here and abroad? And on the other hand, the surprising success of smart meters, even when those meters are not likely to lower bills. How is energy law prone to disruption? And how durable are its core principles in the face of technological, economic, and regulatory disruptions that are part of the green energy transition? How is climate change governance a complicated social and political problem as much as it is a material concern? How do social movements influence everything from the adoption of new technology to implementation of the Clean Power Plan to regional responses to the green energy transition? That's just a sampling of the number of issues that we're going to be broaching today. There's an awful lot to say, so let's get to it. Let me be, in order to do that, let's hear a welcome from Professor Macy.
Thank you, Bill, for those nice well wishes. I appreciate it. And also thanks to Liz Alper for all your hard work in making sure that this symposium got off the ground today. We all owe her a great debt of gratitude. So why are we here today? You know, many of us are asking this question. And I just want to give some kind of 30,000, maybe 80,000 foot remarks for a couple of moments before we begin and dive into the substance. And we're here in part because 16 years ago, atmospheric scientist Dr. Paul Crutzen stood up at a conference and he said, "We don't live in the Holocene, we live in the Anthropocene." And this was kind of an exciting new idea, an idea about a new epoch where human beings are viewed as a geological force unto themselves. And there's disagreement that arose after that remark about when the Anthropocene began. Some say that it began in the 1780s, when James Watt patented the steam engine, ushering in what some refer to as the carbonification of the atmosphere. Some people point to an earlier time, maybe when human beings began to engage in the arts of farming and deforestation on a global scale. But there's no doubt that human beings now alter everything, from the atmosphere to surface temperatures to the acidity of the oceans, first gradually, and then in some respects exponentially, starting in the middle of the 20th century. The Anthropocene was ushered in by a dramatic rise in energy use, which allows our species to do remarkable things. For one, we used that energy, first coal, then hydrocarbons, uranium, to fell, till, plow, pave, and plan our cities and crops, which now cover over a third of all land. As we sit in this room, 90% of all photosynthesis on this planet takes place in areas that have undergone some change to serve our needs. And of course, some of that ancient biomass ends up in the atmosphere. And we have known now that the concentration of CO2 has risen from 280 parts per million at the dawn of the industrial era to levels that perhaps we haven't seen in 3 million years. But this is not actually why we're here today. Our job is not to chart the course of epochs or even to proclaim a new age or a stage. As much as the green energy transition promises at least a partial answer to the climate crisis, we should be wary of such claims. After all, we heard about energy transitions for the first time in the modern era, in the 1970s, as part of the Department of Energy and others' efforts to lobby for the alternative fuels of that day, whether it be nuclear power or shale oil and gas. Now, we don't merely transition from wood to coal, coal to oil, bridge fuels to solar cells and wind turbines. Each source of energy has its own staying power. Indeed, the most coal that was ever burned was last year. And so the illusion of transitions speaks to why we're really here today. We're here because, in the words of Dale Jameson in his work Reason in a Dark Time, it seems that in the Anthropocene, things, not people, are in control. These things include technologies, institutions, economic systems, corporations, elements of Thomas Hughes, what he would refer to as technological systems that evolve over considerable periods of time, that link physical artifacts, organizations, resources, regulations, and other elements. These systems, as David Hess would say, acquire momentum as they grow, meaning there is no simple transition, there is no easy fix. We must wrestle with these large lumbering systems and their component parts to truly understand what efforts to turn away from carbon-intensive forms of energy, what works, where we truly stand. We must grapple with these technological systems at different scales, using unique levels of analysis and a mix of theoretical tools. And the people who are seated around this table are, in my opinion, uniquely qualified to discuss how such research both has and should proceed, because they have approached energy systems, their path dependence, their imprints on law and the other way around, the institutions and artifacts that sustain them, and the social movements that seek to reframe them from varied disciplines, but sometimes through very striking and similar analytic tools. So today we'll hear four groups of legal and social theorists. We'll hear them tackle these energy systems. We'll hear them try to explain their political economy, their durability, their susceptibility to change within unique social fields, and the social movements that target them. And the goal is probably more mundane than the post-carbon world that brought you here might suggest. But I believe it's no less important, because to explain even a small piece of the move to embrace clean energy, to bend the arc of history even slightly, is to embrace the possibility of a better world. So we're going to start with a panel of legal scholars who are going to talk about political economy of the green energy transition from three different perspectives, and then we'll move from there. So I hope you have a good time today.
So I think Greg's introduction actually kind of introduces my talk, parts of what he said, better than I was planning on doing it. We're not at 30,000 feet, but we're not on the ground with my talk either. I'm speaking not based on any new original piece of empirical research, but rather talking about really sort of a broader strategic question about the transition to a decarbonized energy system. And what I want to focus on are some of the unintended consequences of the sort of driving policy instruments that we tend to focus on in transitioning to a decarbonized energy sector, particularly the electricity sector. So most of what I'm going to talk about focuses on that. And most of those paradoxes, I'm calling them, and I've changed the title of my talk from what it says in the handout, partly because Eric and I had essentially the same title, but partly because I wanted to focus on these particular, what I'm calling paradoxes. Some of them probably aren't technically paradoxes, but it sounds cooler to call them paradoxes. And so, but they're really sort of ways in which collectively many of these policy instruments are pushing us toward more renewables on the system, less reliance on fossil fuels, but also towards other kinds of problems on the system that we need to take, be cognizant of as we do this. And most of this is about how we sometimes lose sight of, particularly on the policy side, of the fact that decisions about what's going to get built, what electric generating plants are going to get built, and what plants are going to be dispatched to serve load each day are essentially economic decisions made on a least cost basis. And that all the fuels are constantly competing to get cheaper and to get, you know, dispatched more often and cheaper to build and all that sort of thing. And so when we plan, when we think about the possibility of getting to, you know, 80-100% decarbonization, we have to pay attention to that, the economic reality on the ground. And so I'm sort of taking as background here the set of policy instruments you see on the left, or I guess dynamics you see on the left, growth in renewables due to both cost reasons and policy reasons, both at the utility scale and also at the distributed scale, rooftop solar and things like that, as well as regulatory pressure and cost pressure on fossil fuels that's driving particularly coal slowly out of the market, or at least to a smaller share of the market. And my basic thesis here is that if we just sort of plunge ahead trying to keep doing those things, trying to increase the percentage of renewables and treat all fossil fuels alike as sort of something to get rid of, we're going to have some unintended consequences. Most of these are consequences that individually people have written about before, so I'm not claiming these are original ideas, but I think when we think about them, it leads to the conclusion that sometimes this direct route might not be the best route to a sustainably low-carbon future. So I'm calling these three paradoxes, the reliability paradox, the health paradox, and the fairness paradox. The reliability paradox could be the reliability and cost paradox. That is, the electric system, we sort of want it to do three things. We want it to provide reliable electricity at a reasonable cost, and we want it to be as green as possible. And there are always trade-offs between all those things. So when you push hard on one button, something happens to the other buttons. And so that's what that first paradox about. The health is about. The health paradox is about the difference between the notion that all fossil fuels are not alike when it comes to health and environmental harm. And the fairness paradox is really about distributed generation. It's the sort of famous, now called the utility death spiral, but the notion that distributed generation may benefit the relatively well-off at the expense of the real not-so-well-off. And so that's the short version of what I want to talk about. I'm talking fast because I only have 20 minutes and I probably brought too many slides, so I may skip some of the slides. We'll see. I think everybody knows this, that the electric grid is operated as one big machine, or three big machines, I guess, is a better way of describing it, but that when power plants are dispatched to serve load each day, they are dispatched on something called the Security Constrained Economic Dispatch Rule, or SCED rule, which basically means that you use the cheapest plants first. And when we say cheapest, we mean the cheapest on a marginal cost basis. And so the wind and solar, being zero marginal cost fuels, will be dispatched whenever they're able to generate, assuming their use doesn't jeopardize the security of the system. At the same time, we have this change over the last 30 years or so that has introduced much more competition and market pricing into the electric system, creating sort of three types of markets. I'm calling them a fully competitive market, a place like Texas, a place like New York, where both retail markets and wholesale markets are robust and competitive. Then you have places like the Southeast, which I'm calling traditional markets, where you still have the old system of a monopoly utility, not really, they don't really have to buy on the wholesale market if they don't want to. They can if they want to, but they don't have to. They could choose to continue to generate all the power they sell their customers and sell it at a regulated retail price. And then you have hybrid markets, which exist in much of the middle of the country, MISO and that sort of region, where you have a lot of states that don't have retail competition. You still have the Public Utility Commission setting prices, but there's pretty robust wholesale markets at which retailers buy the power that they can sell to customers. This is sort of foundational here for the discussion of the paradoxes that I wanted to talk about. So the reliability paradox exists on both sort of a short-term and a long-term basis. The short-term version is that if you increase renewables on the system, you need to back them up with something. Yes, geographically dispersed wind and solar is more reliable as a whole than isolated solar is or isolated wind is, but you still need to have backup if you want to have a reliable electricity system, so that if wind does die in zone B and you have to serve load from zone A either has to be huge to serve the whole, every place the wind's not blowing, or you're gonna need some backup reliable generation like natural gas or coal or nuclear. And what that means is that you're cycling up these fossil fuel plants up and down over time to respond to the wind. Remember, wind gets dispatched first, and so when wind dies down, you have to bring the fossil fuel plants up. If wind starts up again, fossil fuel plants have to cycle down. And when you keep that in mind, what you find is that wind on the system doesn't amount to an equal percentage of reduction in pollution. And this is something that's been measured quite a bit through a series of studies NREL has done, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, in both the Eastern Grid and the Western Grid. This is just a graph from their Eastern Grid study that shows the percentage of reduction in pollution associated with a 20% renewable generation on the system over across a number of different scenarios. But you see, you don't get a 20% reduction, obviously, in pollution when you have 20% wind added to the system. That's the sort of short-term version. Now, with the longer-term version of the reliability problem, here's, by the way, sorry, this is part of the reason you don't get that greater reduction in pollution is because sometimes you're cycling coal-fired power plants up and down. Coal-fired power plants still, despite how cheap gas has become, still have lower variable costs than gas-fired plants. And this is the data from the EIA. The boxes denote the sort of variable O&M costs for coal and combined cycle natural gas. And so in some places, you're cycling coal-fired power plants up and down. They weren't built to run that way. That means they're generating more pollution per unit of energy. And they're wearing out quicker as well. And so that's the reason for that. The long-term version of this is as you get more and more wind and solar on the system, and they're being dispatched whenever they're running, you get more zero marginal costs on the system. And marginal cost is how spot markets are priced. And so that means long-run spot market prices go down, down, down. And in places like Texas at night, they go negative because wind generators have earned production tax credits for dispatching their power. And so what that means is that everybody else has lower marginal, or is making less money selling on the spot market. And if you're seeing a future where the long run spot market prices are likely to be lower than your long run average costs, you're not going to build a plant to serve load. And that's the long run reliability problem that more and more wind and solar causes. If you think about it from the prospective investor's point of view, it's a pretty uncertain world out there for a power plant. You might have lots more wind, lots more solar, so your spot market prices are low. You may have more carbon regulation. Who knows what's going to happen with the clean power plan and the new source performance standard for GHGs. And so there's lots of uncertainty. And so unless you have some sort of guarantee, some sort of reason to build, you're not going to build. And these are the EIA, Energy Information Administration, estimates of the levelized cost of energy for a new plant in each of these technologies. That's sort of roughly corresponds to the long run average cost. That's how much you have to, that's the money that you have to make back over the life of the plant. And Yeah, if you don't make that back, if the spot markets are going to be persistently lower than that, then the plants are not going to get built. And so in places that don't have some sort of guaranteed rate of return, the competitive and hybrid systems that I told you about before, if you don't have a guaranteed return on investment, you're not going to build. And so that's why some of those markets have gone to what are called capacity markets, where they pay generators to essentially be there, whether or not they get into the dispatch order and sell power. And if you look at the places that don't have capacity markets, from the bar graph in the lower right, you can guess which two zones don't have capacity markets here. ERCOT, which is my market in Texas, and MISO, which is the Midwest, Mid-Continent ISO. They're facing their reserve, they're getting down to their reserve, almost below their reserve targets, because they're not giving prospective builders of new power plants an incentive to build in these competitive wholesale markets. And I was just talking in the break with someone about the fact that the Texas PUC commissioner, who was most against having a capacity market, is now starting to think, well, maybe we should study this again. So what we need to do in competitive markets is intervene to ensure reliability by paying power plant owners of mainly reliable sources, that is not the wind and solar, but what EIA would call dispatchable sources of power, to be there in order to make sure the system is running or continues to provide power when we need it. Okay, the health paradox. So what I'm talking about here is the notion that we talk about decarbonization as if sort of greenhouse gases were the only important problem with fossil fuels. I go to these conferences all the time and we all talk about GHGs and GHG levels and how we're going to reduce GHGs. And leads us to treat gas and coal alike in a lot of these conversations, and they are not alike when it comes to the harm they do. This is data taken from the regulatory impacts assessment for the Clean Power Plan, and if you look at the benefits of essentially closures of coal-fired power plants that would result from the Clean Power Plan, and you try to quantify them as EPA did, the vast majority of those benefits are not associated with reduction of greenhouse gases. They're associated with reduction of other pollutants that come from coal-fired power plants, like particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, ozone precursors, and the like. Those come from coal-fired power plants, not from gas. If you compare coal to gas and you try to quantify the premature deaths attributable to each, which tend to dominate these estimates of the benefits of closing the plants, you see huge disparities. And this is consistent throughout the literature that tries to estimate this stuff. There's been a number of sort of high-profile studies in the last 5 years or so. The Skeptical Science website tried to turn two of those studies into sort of bar charts here. But basically what you're looking at are, in the yellow are climate benefits, and in the red are the other air pollution benefits that there's essentially the harm done by coal-fired power. That's what we're measuring here in these. And you can see that the climate benefits are quite a bit smaller than the other benefits. And if you look at the right-hand two bar graphs, they're trying to essentially estimate how much the price of electricity would be if the harm calculated in their study was internalized in the price of electricity. And in the American Economic Review study, which is the MMN study, you know, it's $0.03 to $0.035, which is a fairly good-sized chunk of the current price of electricity. If you look at the full life cycle cost of coal, which is the right-hand study, the Epstein et al. Study, it's enormous. It doubles the price of electricity. If you do the same thing with the pollution that comes out of gas-fired power plants, you get a much smaller number. So this is from the Moeller, Mendelson, and Nordhaus study in the American Economic Review 2011. This is a chart that tries to estimate the general environmental damages, that's what GED is, and VA is value added to the economy. And they did this for over 800 industries. So I'm just focusing on fossil fuel combustion here. And you can see the overall number of general environmental damages, but on the left-hand side, you're looking at the ratios of general environmental damages to value added without considering greenhouse gas emissions. And you're looking at In the second bar, the second box, you're with greenhouse gas emissions included. And you see that oil combustion has a terrible ratio, but the sort of total environmental damages associated with coal dwarf both oil and gas. But more importantly, if we look at the far right here and look at how much electricity prices would go up according to these authors if we internalize the pollution associated with all three forms of power production, you get a 3.5 cents increase in coal, and you get less than 0.5 cent increase in natural gas price of electricity. So I don't think it's it's another way of saying I don't think we should be lumping these two together as readily as we often do. I'm old enough to remember to have thought about, you know, we've been trying to get old, dirty coal plants shut down for a very long time. And in the electric system, gas plants compete with coal plants in many parts of the country to get into that dispatch order. And if we're going to treat a gas plant as just as worthy of our opposition as a coal-fired power plant, then I don't know why we would do that, given that coal-fired power plants are responsible for roughly 10,000 premature deaths a year in the United States, and the estimates for natural gas plants are about 500. So that's what I mean by the health paradox. I think, yes, we should be worrying about the climate impacts, but there's a lot of other environmental impacts as well that seem, at least when we try to quantify them, at least as important. Just to sort of illustrate my point that nationally these two fuels compete against each other in the electric generation mix, I took data from EIA for as far back as it went. I need to update this, but you look at the last sort of basically the era of the shale gas revolution, and you see these two sort of mirror images of one another. You see that gas is displacing coal. This is before the Mercury Rule, before a clean power plant. It's the market driving coal-fired power out of business. And I would sure hate for gas plants to be hobbled by either higher gas prices or other rules that allow these old coal-fired power plants, the average age, 50 years on our system, and some are 60, 70 years old. We thought they would be dead by now, but we can't quite seem to drive a stake through their hearts. and so I worry about disabling gas-fired power plants in this transition and letting coal back into the mix. Okay, the fairness paradox. You'll probably hear more about this. This is the idea that this is really associated with rooftop solar and distributed generation. In the traditional systems or the hybrid systems, where the customer pays a bundled rate for both the electricity that they buy and the service of delivering it to them over the grid. That is, they don't pay a separate price for using the grid and a separate price for power, which is most of the country. They pay this bundled price. Then the costs of the grid are recovered through that volumetric charge based on how much electricity you use. And if more and more people go off the grid or use a lot less electricity because they now have rooftop solar, then the costs of running the grid, maintaining the grid, investing in the grid are going to be shifted to those who are still using the old sort of amount of electricity that they use because they don't have rooftop solar. And so that's essentially a regressive thing. In this little picture on the lower left, the generators are in boxes and the consumers are in circles. And we have 9 consumers and $72 of cost for the entire system, $8 a person that's their bill. If we lose a few of those consumers because they've all gone off and taken rooftop solar is where they get their power, and they have net metering so that they can cancel out their retail bill for the amount of power they generate, then the rest of us have to pay more on that system. And since people that tend to invest in rooftop solar tend to be relatively well off compared to the people that don't, that's the regressive nature of this. Now, the rejoinder to this is that, well, with distributed generation, we don't have transmission costs. And we don't have distribution costs. And that's true if you don't want to be continue connected to the grid anymore. So if we completely disconnect from the grid, then that's a fair comparison. But if you want access to the grid as backup power, then on a fairness basis, you should pay your fair share of the amount of the grid that is there for you to use when you need it, presumably when your rooftop solar panel isn't working and it's and you need electricity. And so most people, I don't think, really want to exit the grid. They want it there as a backup. And so the traditional pricing system poses, combined with net metering and the widespread adoption of rooftop solar, creates this kind of problem. Here's the most recent estimates of the levelized costs of rooftop solar versus utility scale solar. The top line is rooftop solar, and the bottom line is utility scale. You can't see the numbers perhaps, but it's a range of $184 per kilowatt hour, or megawatt hour rather, to $300 per megawatt hour for rooftop solar. And for photovoltaic utility scale solar, we're down in the $50 to $70 range. Really comparable to other generation technologies, if assuming you don't think about the backup or the need to build transmission out to the utility scale solar. So much more efficient, much cheaper as a generation technology than rooftop solar. Okay, so we should think about what we want to subsidize. There's a big controversy, Alex has written about this and others here, Jim as well, about how broadly we ought to spread the cost of new transmission lines that are built to serve utility scale renewables. On the theory that everybody's benefiting from these renewables, that we're all gaining reliability benefits and environmental benefits, from the transmission line, and reliability benefits from the transmission line and clean energy from the renewables. Does that same logic apply on a distribution system with rooftop solar? Should the other people on that distribution grid be subsidizing the rooftop solar owner's access to the grid in that way? That's a decision we have to make, and that's one I think we ought to make explicitly, as opposed to sort of burying it in a net metering regime. Or if we're going to choose a net metering regime, we ought to choose it with the acknowledgement that that's what we're doing. And I don't think we normally do. So maybe I'm a minute over, but this is what I meant in the synopsis when I said the perfect can be the enemy of the good. I think we want to be cognizant of the unintended consequences of what we're doing. And sometimes the market is really, really powerful. And the policies we enact to try and move the market are kind of like a tugboat trying to turn around an ocean liner in the ocean. It's the market forces that affect what plants get dispatched, what plants get built. Who adopts rooftop solar? All these things are very, very powerful forces, and we need to be cognizant of that power as we push these regulatory instruments forward. And I think I'll stop there.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's a privilege to be here. As you can see, the issue that I'm going to put on the table really is what can the United States learn from Germany and California about legal ways to decarbonize. Now, before I get too far into the weeds on this, sort of a moment of support for what Professor Macy said. We're not at an interesting time in human history. We're at an interesting time in either geological or earth science history, it's a situation we really have no precedent for. This is a NASA graph. Surface temperature measurements, land oceans, all over the place, going all the way back to 1880. And an interesting, this is done in degrees centigrade. You can see the curve rising pretty much since about 1970. Figure out where you were born on that chart. Take the little centigrade number and multiply it by 2. That'll give you the number of degrees Fahrenheit by which average surface temperatures have increased since you were born. Now, we have a framework convention at the global level, a treaty that was ratified by the United States in 1992 under the first Bush administration to address climate change. It doesn't say stabilize greenhouse gas levels at pre-industrial levels. It says hold the increase to a level that won't be dangerous. The Paris Agreement in late 2015, which you probably heard about, grew out of that convention. It's the first time ever since 1992 that all countries in the world have agreed to take some action to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It's a very, very, very big deal. And what it does is it says, well, let's hold the average surface temperature increase, if we can, to well below 2 degrees centigrade. And that, by the way, includes the warming I've already shown you. So it's not like well below 2 new degrees centigrade. It's well below what we've already put into the atmosphere. And it indicates if you can hold the temperature to 1.5, which is a little lower, that would be even better. Now, what countries did in Paris, basically, and is they said, well, what we're going to try to do, and there's a lot on the slide, and as you can probably tell by now, I'm not going to read everything on all the slides. But one of the things that they said is, let's get to zero, net zero, by the second half of the century. And countries all agreed to that, to sort of peak their emissions and reduce them down to get to net zero by the second half of the century. And the mechanism is something called a nationally determined contribution, which is a promise that countries make, each country makes, to do its best, really, to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And everyone knew going into the conference that the NDCs, or INDCs, if you will, that had been submitted so far were not going to be adequate. There may be about half the reduction necessary. And so what is said in the Paris Agreement is, let's have countries submit more ambitious nationally determined contributions every 5 years. The critical point here is that this international effort is the sum total of each country's effort. And that's really the frame that came out of Paris. Now, what does that mean then for the United States? Well, what it means for the United States is, if you look at the science and so forth, is reducing greenhouse gas emissions by more than 80% from 1990 levels by 2050. And if you look at some other science and you say, well, what does that mean on an annual basis, you're looking at maybe 4 to 5% annual reductions. This is a big deal, and it's really hard. If you look between now and 2050, we're staring at 9 presidential elections. I don't have to tell you what parties are saying now, different individuals are saying now. And frankly, it's really hard for me. I would love to hear what folks think about analogous historical experiences we have of going from one state of affairs to another state of affairs this dramatic over multiple generations. It's a big, hard problem. Now, here's the question, though, that I'm posing, and I'm going to take a shot at answering it in my presentation. But I'm also interested in what you all have to think about this. Is there are some leaders out there, Germany, California, and they're not small countries. Bhutan, by the way, claims to be carbon neutral already, but I chose not to talk about Bhutan for reasons that I think you can probably guess. And the question is, what can we learn from them? What can we learn from them? And so what I'm going to do to try and answer that is I'm going to talk a little bit about a couple of different projects that are sort of creating pathways for deep decarbonization, including one in which Mike Girard and I are beginning, spent a little bit of time talking about targets and timetables that exist in Germany, California, and the United States, a little bit about what they've done, and then I'm going to try and sketch some lessons. The Deep Decarbonization Pathways Project, there's a couple of non-governmental organizations leading an international project involving 17 countries. And what they're looking to try and do is figure out technologically or technically feasible pathways to deep decarbonization in the countries that account for the greatest global greenhouse gas emissions. First stage of this was completed in 2014, and there's a more recent stage. A lot of their stuff was posted at the end of 2015. But that's basically what they're trying to do. And I should say that there are individual reports for each country, and the U.S. report is pretty interesting. Here's what the U.S. report says. One, it's technically feasible to get to an 80% reduction by 2050, and it wouldn't cost all that much, 1% of U.S. GDP. What would that mean? Well, and this is what I like about this project, by the way, is we go from sort of an abstract sense of talking about decarbonization to concrete outcomes in 2050. And it helps us visualize what this would actually mean. And they say, well, what this would actually mean is, and oh, I'm sorry, one more thing. The folks that wrote this report is a consulting firm in California and technical people from two government energy labs. So I think it comes in at a pretty high level of sophistication and credibility. And they say, well, look, you, in order to get there, you've really got to decarbonize the electricity supply by 2050. And what you have to do is you have to pretty much move all liquid fuels, gasoline in particular, over to either electricity or hydrogen. And here's an interesting thought experiment. How do you get 300 million alternative fuel vehicles on the road by 2050? How do you do that? What you do basically is you something like double electricity generation to do that, and you push it a lot of it over into renewables or fairly substantial amounts of carbon capture and sequestration. And that's just, you know, you might say, wow, that sounds like a lot. But if you want to talk about decarbonization and think about what does that mean in concrete terms, what I like about this particular project is it gives you a way of thinking about that. Now, this is the project, as I mentioned, that Mike Girard, who's sitting in the audience, are beginning to work on. And the question that we're trying to ask is, well, okay, the deep decarbonization pathways folks have given us sort of technically feasible routes. Well, what legal routes exist? What legal pathways or approaches exist? And our thought process is somewhat similar in a way to what the technical folks are doing, and that is if you can picture what the laws are, if you can figure out what the legal barriers are, if you can identify various kinds of legal pathways that might exist, you have a better idea of thinking about how to actually get there. So when I'm looking at Germany and California, and when I'm asking you questions about what we can learn from Germany and California, the question that I'm really asking in a basic way is, what can our project learn about how to do our project better from the experience of two places that are in serious leadership positions on climate change? Now, so just a couple of things about targets and timetables that different jurisdictions have set. I've got a couple of slides that give you sort of what's going on. Here, let's just start with this. U.S. said in the commitment that Obama made was 20 to 26% below 2005 levels by 2025. And you say, well, okay, so what are U.S. greenhouse gas emissions look like now? This chart takes you back to 1990, and what you can see is beginning in about 2006-07, we appear to have peaked. The reduction that you see is a whole lot about gas in the economy. Gas is displacing coal, as David pointed out. So Germany is part of the European Union. The European Union has an 80% commitment from 1990 levels by 2050. There's some intermediate goals. One of the intermediate goals found its way into the commitment that was made under the climate change treaty. And so you see the European Union pushing out a little further. Germany says, we're going to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions 40% below 1990 levels by 2020. And we're going to push them down 80 to 95%. Actually, they're more ambitious than the Europeans because the Germans see themselves as a leadership position within Europe, see themselves as being obliged to actually go beyond 80% because there's other countries like Slovenia and Slovakia that are probably not going to be at their level. The chart shows actually their greenhouse gas emissions reduction since 1990. It's a 27% reduction. You might say, well, yeah, but there's Eastern Europe and that changes everything. And I get that, but it's interesting to see sort of the continuing reduction in greenhouse gas emissions over time on this chart. And so the Germans say, well, all right, so here's how we get there. We take what we've already got in terms of reductions, and you can project it forward, and there's a couple of different target trajectories. If you get to 95%, you're on one of those lines. If you're on 80%, you get to another. And you can also see the different sectors that the Germans are interested in talking about. And one of the lessons from this chart, which I think is terribly important, is there's no sort of silver bullet. You can't say, well, let's just all have electric cars, or let's just everybody do one thing with, I don't know, renewable energy or whatever. There's a lot of different things that have to be done, and there's a lot of different sectors that have to be addressed. And that's a pretty important slice of reality here. California is interesting because California's got a goal of an 80% reduction. That goal was set under Governor Schwarzenegger years ago. Well, not that many years ago. Their statute says let's at least get to 1990 levels by 2020, and there's a more recent executive order that sets an intermediate goal. So what did California look like? I couldn't find a bar graph that takes you back to 1990, and I searched. Maybe Eric has it somewhere, but I couldn't find it. But you get a sense of what California's greenhouse gas emissions are looking like, slight reduction since about 2007, 2008. So that gives you a sense of where all these jurisdictions are. If you sort of take all the targets and timetables together and you say, well, what does this all look like? What you get is a couple of things that are really interesting, I think. Okay, one is Germany and California have a longer-term goal than the United States. You can see that. They're thinking out to 2050. A second thing is they're using a more ambitious baseline year. 1990 greenhouse gas emission levels were much lower than they were in 2005. And I think those two things, I think, sort of jump out. So in terms of, well, what Germany and California are doing, I'm going to be extremely brief on this because I have limited time, but I want to highlight a couple of things. First of all, Germany's part of the EU emissions trading system. They're about 12, 11 years in now on emissions trading. About 45% of Germany's greenhouse gas emissions are covered by that. They have a renewable energy statute that has ramped up considerably the amount of renewable energy used in Germany. And there are complaints about subsidies and it's cost too much and all the rest of that, but that's at least what they're doing. And interestingly, and perhaps in contradiction to the first two things, they made a decision to phase out nuclear power by 2022. So where do you get 25% of your electricity from if you're going to get rid of nuclear power by 2022? There was a last year in Paris, there was a side event at which a bunch of German officials spoke about their climate action plan. They're planning on having their plan to achieve decarbonization by the middle of this year. They used an incredibly intensive stakeholder process, outreached everyone, and they're saying they can do it. And it's interesting, the pillars that they talk about for successful transformation, I think, are interesting. It's one, create an on-ramp for renewable energy, create an off-ramp, okay, for fossil fuels, make sure you put appropriate infrastructure in place, which is important, and then finally, and maybe trickier, is make necessary technological innovations work on time. That's basically the kind of thing that they're looking at. California has a long history in this area. You take a look at what they've been doing in energy efficiency for electricity, you can see they basically flatlined per capita electricity consumption based on a boatload of different measures and approaches. They also have a long history in California, stringent fuel economy, and even more recently, greenhouse gas emission standards for motor vehicles. AB 32, the Global Warming Solutions Act, is a 2006 statute that is pretty comprehensive. Interesting thought experiment. Imagine the United States if we had a statute even remotely like that that had been adopted 10 years ago. So what do we get out of all of that? Well, here, I want to sketch some things, and again, I don't pretend to have all the answers, but I want to sketch some things that seem to me to sort of jump out when I look at all of this. Okay. One is, I think if you're going to do decarbonization, you've got to do decarbonization, and you've got to focus on what the science says about that. You've got to create goals that are actually based on that. What the United States is doing is great, but I think what the federal government has been obliged to do is put together a goal based on what it could achieve. If you're going to be really thinking about decarbonization, I think you've got to figure out where that takes you and then sort of do some backcasting to figure out how to get there and set goals based on that. It's reasonably clear to me as a second point that a good carbon price helps a whole lot. Germany and California through cap and trade both have something of a carbon tax. I'm showing numbers that I think are reasonably close to reality, and I don't really think you can say fairly that the United States has any kind of a carbon price now at all. I see laws as building blocks. I don't think there's any such thing as a magic bullet here or a silver bullet. Another metaphor I've used a lot is silver buckshot instead of a silver bullet. And the question is, how do you build those laws? What combination of laws do you employ? Understanding that there are a lot of building blocks provides for some of us a little bit of solace after the Supreme Court stay of the Clean Power Plan, recognizing that the Clean Power Plan is only one part of what the U.S. is doing. Harmonization of different laws is incredibly important, and you can read David Spence's really thoughtful presentation just before me as a meditation on that exact point. The example I use here is from Germany. And you can make an argument that the way the feed-in tariffs are structured in Germany has actually helped contribute to the rise of lignite, which is really nasty coal. The phase-out of nuclear power did not exactly help things either in Germany. And so if you're going to use different building blocks, they've got to fit together. You can't just kind of keep throwing one thing and another thing and another thing. And some rational approach to making all the pieces fit together is terribly important. Sustainable development is, I think, the way forward. David touched on this, but I want to develop this in a little bit more detail. Giving you a little bit of a conceptual map of how conventional development actually works, my thinking on this is deeply informed by actually reading the texts. I'm not a sustainable development speaker who has my own ideas. I try to adhere to what's been agreed to internationally and what people are saying. And internationally, development is understood as a way of improving human freedom, opportunity, and quality of life. And it was really conceptualized, and I think in a pretty serious way, right at the end of World War II, when the UK and US and other countries are saying, how do we build something that's going to prevent all this nasty business with Germany and world wars and a Great Depression. And they said, well, look, we're going to anchor it in three building blocks: peace and security, economic development, or social development, or human rights. That's how we're going to anchor it. And that's what development is really about. And if you do that, people are going to be happy and you won't have wars and so forth. People have opportunities. But the post-war development model didn't have really say much about the environment. And so the environment and natural resources become part of the price of progress. And it's not just the environment that gets harmed by conventional development. It's people. You do something bad to the environment, this is really a pretty important point. Conceptually, a lot of us sort of want to wall off the environment and, well, if you care about the environment, that's really nice, but I've got a serious things to care about. And to which I might say, well, do you drink water? Do you breathe the air? Do you eat food? Pretty much everything you do to the environment that adversely affects the environment sooner or later hurts someone else. So that's how conventional development works. Sustainable development would say, well, let's keep all that good stuff on the progress side, but let's move environmental protection and restoration over to the progress side. Let's make those things work together. So it's not the environment versus the economy, it's the environment and the economy. Well, what does that mean? And this is really relevant to climate change, because the whole point of this, I think, and a lot of what's going on with climate change is going to be deeply inequitable and deeply harmful to a lot of human beings. And so what we're looking at when we move towards sustainable development, when we move to a new clean economy, when we move toward the things we're going to be talking about today, the claim you can make is, look, this is more equitable because it doesn't create all those bad impacts. Okay? There's a broader range of benefits, the co-benefits that David and I talked about, and it has fewer costs. And so sustainable development isn't just another word for green. It's a sophisticated conceptual framework, and once you understand it, it helps put a lot of these things in place. So what does that mean here? People aren't going to experience benefits from reductions in greenhouse gas emissions. What they're going to experience is what David described: economic development, job creation, human health that is better. And so the challenge, I think, in front of us is design legal measures that maximize those co-benefits and reduce the cost. The questions that David asked are very real, but the design questions, and we're really truly designing designing our own future when we do this, need to be addressed. But if they're addressed successfully, we get people being in a much better place than they otherwise would be. Finally, public support and participation are utterly, utterly essential. I was blown away at the side event in Paris last year by the Germans, because they're sitting there. There's somebody from the business community. There's somebody there from civil society. There's an academic guy, and they're all talking in the same way, and they're all sort of nodding and saying, yeah, this decarbonization thing, this is real for us, and we're going to make it work. All right, California defeated an effort to repeal AB 32, partly on the strength of the economic and health benefits that AB 32 is providing that state's economy. And the final point I would make is that the public needs to be able to tolerate trial and error. This is not easy. There's going to be bumps in the road. Germany certainly experienced some of those. And the public support has to be great enough that we can tolerate that. Anyway, that's it. Thank you. And I seriously, seriously invite your questions, comments, and suggestions on other lessons that we can get from this. Thank you so much.
So building on the earlier comments, there's an urgent need to decarbonize more. Current international national commitments are not yet at the level we need to get those reductions. I think it's fair to say, at least in the econ literature, and I think derivatively in much of the law and policy and management literature, there's a major focus on which policy tools will reduce carbon emissions in the most economically efficient manner. If political considerations are considered, they're usually dismissed as problems outside the scope of the analysis, rent-seeking that's selfish, that should be overcome by brave political leadership. To the extent politics is explicitly considered in the analysis, much of the focus is often on short-term dynamics, what tools can be enacted right now. Often, cap and trade is better than carbon tax. But as the earlier presentations made clear, decarbonization is a long-term process that will proceed for decades. So what matters is not just what we're doing right now, but what we'll be able to do over time in the future. And that requires a dynamic analysis of how the legal and policy choices we make today affect what is politically feasible in the future. So what legal and policy choices can we make today that will most likely make deeper and bigger reductions in carbon emissions feasible down the road, and equally important, reduce the risk of backsliding? So I'm part of an interdisciplinary team of researchers at UC Berkeley that are looking at these questions. Everyone but me is a political scientist. I'm the token law person. And we're drawing on our work analyzing experiences in Germany, Denmark, California, the international ozone regulation negotiations from the 1980s and 1990s, and a range of other countries and jurisdictions to try and develop some understanding of what kinds of legal and policy tools will best facilitate deep reductions in carbon emissions in the future. So our first cut at this as a team was looking at sequencing of carbon reduction policies across countries around the world. So in an article that we published in Science, we reviewed the policies for 54 countries and subnational entities that had adopted a carbon pricing scheme by 2013. By carbon pricing, I mean either a carbon tax or a cap and trade system. We found that nearly two-thirds of these jurisdictions had installed a feed-in tariff or renewable portfolio standards before setting up the carbon pricing system. And in fact, for the 19 countries that had begun carbon policy with a carbon pricing system, 13 of them were late entrants to the European Union, so they inherited carbon pricing because of EU policy. It was not a domestic initiative. Or they already had very high percentages of energy from nuclear and or hydroelectric power. So the lesson we drew from this analysis and our other individual work on various case studies is that carbon pricing may not be the best initial step to take in developing a decarbonization policy agenda. Reduction of carbon emissions is necessarily politically contentious because it threatens important economic and political interests, for instance, coal miners in Germany and the United States. To enact an economy-wide carbon pricing system in the face of that resistance is difficult politically. And even if successful, it will likely that such a price in carbon will be relatively moderate. Indeed, one critique of the existing EU, California, and Northeastern US pricing systems, and that John put up the numbers a little bit before, is precisely that they set the price of carbon so low. So what's the problem with low carbon pricing? From a political dynamics perspective, the problem is that it doesn't drive changes in the interest group landscape that shape the political realities of decarbonization policy. If there are strong political and economic interests that oppose decarbonization policy, you have three major options. One is to weaken those interests directly through regulation, taxes, and such. This is the Obama administration's famous war on coal, and that obviously has political challenges. Second is to convert some of the opponents into supporters by changing the political and more fundamentally economic dynamics for those actors. So for instance, in California, as John noted, changes in how utilities we're able to set our rates for consumers, decoupled utility revenue streams from the amount of electricity consumers used, which in turn encouraged the utilities to invest more in energy efficiency and reduce their dependence on increasing production to produce profits. Over time, that, along with a series of other changes, has changed the political position of the major investor-owned utilities in California, such that they generally, although not entirely, support decarbonization efforts. Third, you could create or incubate new interest groups with a direct stake in decarbonization efforts. So for instance, you might build up renewable energy industries that would have strong incentives to encourage additional decarbonization policies over time. So what causes changes in interest group perspectives and incentives? Perhaps most importantly, policies that produce changes in investments. If investments by major industry interest groups depend on policies that favor decarbonization, they all have a strong incentive to lobby to continue those policies and perhaps even expand them. So the problem with weak carbon pricing strategies is that they may not facilitate the investments needed to shift interest group perspectives and interests in a significant manner. On the other hand, there are a range of regulatory and financial tools that might encourage these kinds of investments, particularly if they're targeted at specific sectors. These are what we call in our paper green industrial policy. There are tools such as feed-in tariffs, renewable portfolio standards, tax credits, and other direct subsidies for the installation of renewable energy and similar tools. They have the advantage of at least not being directly threatening to existing adverse interest groups. They can be targeted at specific industry sectors, such that relatively small expenditures or specific regulatory tools can produce significant changes in investments. They can nurture the growth of those interest groups over the time. That, in turn, can change the interest group landscape such that more aggressive and indeed more efficient or more effective policies, such as carbon taxes or cap and trade programs that apply to large sectors of the economy and that have meaningful prices, can be implemented. That in turn will inspire further investment changes and changes in interest group perspectives. So based on this analysis, it isn't much of a surprise that carbon pricing generally follows from green industrial policy. That policy was a necessary precondition to getting to carbon pricing. And we can also understand how continuing green industrial policy might be necessary even after the initiation of a carbon pricing system in order to encourage further deepening, broadening, and strengthening of that carbon pricing system. But there's a lot of unanswered questions that our analysis still has to address if we're going to provide real traction and guidance to policymakers seeking to advance decarbonization. And the article we're going to do for this project will be a summary of those questions. We'll develop some tentative hypotheses for those questions and identify some of the key data we may want to rely upon. And so I'll just go over a brief overview of those questions for the rest of my presentation. So first, our analysis necessarily requires engagement with the specific political, economic, and legal context of a particular jurisdiction. How the political process, the legal system, the regulatory system, the economics of a particular country or state operates is a crucial factor in understanding which policy tools will be most effective in advancing decarbonization. So here are some questions that we are thinking of exploring, and one thing that will be very helpful to me in follow-up conversation is, are we looking at the right questions? Are there other questions we should consider? So first, what is the importance of the existing energy resource base and the kinds of energy sources for the economy? How important are they to a particular jurisdiction's economy? So an obvious initial hypothesis would be that higher levels of renewable energy production make it easier to decarbonize. So it's no accident that British Columbia went straight to a carbon tax because 90% of their electricity comes from hydro. Reciprocally, it would be reasonable to expect that higher levels of fossil fuel production or use would make a jurisdiction less amenable to aggressive renewable energy production, for instance, West Virginia. But one of the EU member states that, as John pointed out, is most aggressive in pursuing renewable energy is Germany, which has a very large coal industry. Likewise, Texas is the leader in wind production in the United States, but it's the largest producer of oil and gas in the United States as well. How about low levels of all energy resources, for instance, countries like Korea and Japan? Does that make the policy dynamics easier or harder to initiate, and what kinds of pathways would you choose? And we think here, initially at least, the answers to this broad question are probably going to be sector specific. So for instance, one hypothesis might be that Texas may have been more amenable to wind energy because that's in the electricity sector, while the fossil fuel sector in Texas is dominated by oil and gas, which at least historically, until the move towards gas electricity production, have traditionally been used either in transportation or heating. High levels of renewable energy potential are not determinative either. A good example here is Florida, which has lots of sun, but not much renewable energy. So some kinds of renewable energy resources may be easier to initiate politically than others. Wind is now basically at, wind is more industrial scale. It may be more politically appealing to utilities. Solar, which can at least be used in distributed generation, may be seen as more threatening to utilities, at least in the distributed form. Also, wind at this point may be so cheap that renewable energy policy has relatively little impact on its deployment. At least some preliminary research we're doing indicates that's the case. Reciprocally, strategic development of policy may be even more important in a jurisdiction that is otherwise hostile to renewables because of really cheap fossil fuel energy. A second important question is, how important are the political structures of our jurisdiction for determining which policy tools to use? So a fundamental distinction here would be between a parliamentary political system, where there's one election for a legislature which then determines control of the executive, and a presidential political system like in the United States, where there are separate elections for the legislature and the executive. Basic political science tells us it's easier in general to enact policies in a parliamentary system, but it's also easier to repeal them. And one tenth question is, which is more important to us, ease of initiating action or ensuring lock-in and ensuring that policies are not undermined over time because we want to facilitate investments and the political changes those investments inspire? Likewise, direct democracy tools, do they facilitate or hinder policy development over time or change the tools we might want to use? So there are states like Colorado and Washington that started their decarbonization policies with ballot initiatives. There are also efforts to kill decarbonization, like the unsuccessful ballot initiative in California that John referred to. Relatedly, how important are the political party systems in a jurisdiction? Is a very competitive political environment where you have frequent changes in government helpful or harmful? On the one hand, frequent changes of government might undermine consistency in policy. On the other hand, the threat of losing power may lead parties to try and lock in their policy preferences while they're in power through tools that encourage investments in the private sector. A third question is, how important is the regulatory structure for the energy industry in question? Does deregulation of the energy industry, as has happened in some US states and much of the EU, help or hurt decarbonization policy or change which tools are effective? One argument is that the deregulatory process in California in the 1990s greatly facilitated the transition to decarbonization by forcing incumbent utilities to sell off their fossil fuel-powered generation facilities. Likewise, the enactment of PURPA, someone's going to know the acronym better than me, in the late 1970s in the US might have facilitated the development of entrepreneurial power producers that are more open to experimenting in renewable energy. So again, our preliminary research indicates that independent power producers have played a dominant role in utility-scale regulatory renewable energy in both the US and the EU. And also in some states in the US, PUC, Public Utility Commission rules about who needs approval to generate power and who can receive approval have major impacts on the scale-up of renewable energy. Again, an example here is Florida, where very strict rules about who can get permission, who requires permission, have made it very difficult to roll out substantial renewable energy projects, especially distributed production. If there is a regulatory structure for the energy system, is a more or less independent regulatory body better or worse? If utilities are allies or can be made allies, perhaps you want a captured PUC that can resist pressure from other interest groups. On the other hand, a sector-specific analysis might indicate sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. For instance, utilities are generally at least suspicious of distributed generation. And if you want to facilitate distributed generation, that could be a challenge if the utilities dominate the PUC process. Likewise, does the presence of public versus private power systems change the analysis? So there's states like Nebraska where the entire power system is publicly owned. Does that change what tools work and what pathways are feasible? Another question is, does the kind of renewable energy development, industrial versus distributed, matter for the kinds of strategies that work? So industrial scale renewable energy might mean that utilities put major investments into renewable energy, changing their political position towards decarbonization. Arguably, that's been a factor in California, for instance. Distributed energy, on the other hand, has the advantage of getting lots of politically active voters to have skin in the decarbonization game. Homeowners who've spent thousands of dollars or signed long-term contracts for solar panels have been an important political constituency and have led to quite interesting Tea Party Sierra Club alliances at the state level, fighting PUC efforts to increase transmission charges, as David's referred to on the question of who pays for distributed generation transmission reliability. But industrial power can have this distributed political benefit as well. So for instance, payments by wind turbine farm leases to farm owners in West Texas have been a political factor in that state's development of wind power. And another question is, looking beyond or more deeply than our original article, are there cities where it makes sense to just start with carbon pricing? Is that the case, for instance, in British Columbia? Or if you look at, are there different pros and cons to different green industrial policies? They may have different consequences in different contexts. So there's a general belief, at least, that feed-in tariffs benefit distributed energy more, as in the German context, while renewable portfolio standards benefit industrial-scale production more. Again, our initial research indicates that these policy tools may not actually have such a large difference in terms of the rollout of distributed versus industrial power, and may be swamped, in fact, by other factors. A last question within this universe is, how much does geography matter? So policy diffusion literature talks a lot about how policy diffuses across geographically proximate jurisdictions. So renewable energy in one place may inspire decarbonization in a neighboring jurisdiction. And this may be particularly important to the extent that electric grids cross jurisdictional borders. For instance, Bruce Huber has demonstrated how important components of the way that RGGI developed were determined by which states were in the original RGGI agreement. This is the carbon cap and trade system for the northeastern US. Likewise, demand for renewable energy in California has shaped investments in renewable energy in Oregon and Washington state. There's a separate category of questions that are, I think, equally important, and these get to some of the points that David raised about there are trade-offs among all these tools. So there's potential downsides of thinking about decarbonization through political dynamics. So if the policy and legal choices necessarily to build up interest groups therefore implicitly harm others, what if we get wrong about which interest groups will actually facilitate decarbonization? This might be, for instance, because we guess wrong about which technologies work. There's a reason people pushed corn-based biofuels. There was a thought that they would be helpful initially, and the politics were impeccable, especially because Iowa is the first caucus state in the presidential system in the U.S. Turns out that was not a good choice, and we spent a lot of time trying to undig ourselves from that cul-de-sac. So are there ways to sort of advance policy dynamics and ensure lock-in when it's beneficial, but allow adaptation when it isn't? And that just may not be possible. We may just have to choose, do our best to guess the risks as well as we can. Relatedly, what if over time the political and policy landscape changes? At what point does it become too costly to use green industrial policy? And this is a question the Germans are wrestling with now with their feed-in tariff system. And are we better off switching over to a carbon pricing system? But if we do think we should do that transition, if we've entrenched the interest groups that benefit from the green industrial policy too much, we may not be able to make that transition, or it may be difficult to do. So those are the kinds of questions we're looking to answer with our research over the next few years. To help answer those questions, we're building up a database of information about state and national climate policies, energy systems, regulatory systems, political structures, and other useful data. For this project, we're going to combine qualitative case studies of important jurisdictions with perhaps some small and basic quantitative analysis to refine our hypotheses, reject some, advance others. And over time, we hope to build this process forward to get more sense of what arguments or what policy paths are most plausible or most useful in which contexts. And again, I really am excited to hear feedback about questions we should look at or angles we haven't thought about yet. Thanks very much.
So thanks to all the panelists. Greg has given this panel 10 more minutes, which means we have 5 minutes now for a little discussion before we have to break to our and then get to our next panel. So let me just kind of start it off, and maybe this is maybe the only chance we have for a question, by asking all the panel members to reflect on what seems to me is a couple of commonalities in your presentation. So it seems to me that, number one, the picture facing policymakers and students of policy is highly asymmetrical in all these areas. So, so David, you talked about the concentrated health risks of coal, but also presumably the concentrated economic benefits of coal. John, you talked about the uneven distributional effects of climate change on different countries. And Eric, you talked about the variety of interest groups and how they're all differently situated. And it seems to me that when you combine that kind of asymmetry with the immense complexity of the underlying problem, so again, David, you indicated kind of counterintuitively the best route may not be the most direct route. Eric, you suggested that the most obvious response to the problem, a carbon pricing system, may in fact not be the best way to start. So when you combine that kind of asymmetry with that kind of complexity, I'm wondering if you can find any commonalities in, you know, with regard to how you analyze the problem. Now, I'll throw that to anyone here who wants to answer that deep question in just a couple of minutes.
So they asked me to talk into the microphone, so I'll try to. So first of all, just since your question suggested it, can you hear me? Yeah. So my colleague at Texas, David Adelman, and I have a paper out that tries to look at the distribution geographically of the benefits of a variety of EPA rules that would close down close down coal-fired power plants. And so the benefits are local. But even when you break them down by region, you still get benefits that exceed costs everywhere, in every region. Maybe not in every state, if you're gonna drive West Virginia coal miners out of business, but certainly in my state, where we're one of the states that's at the front of the line to sue the EPA on every opportunity, the benefits dwarf the cost, because not only do we get better health, we sell the gas to everybody else that they're gonna burn instead of burning coal. Even though they're geographically localized, I think when it comes to the policy instruments that hurt the coal industry, that the harm that the coal industry does is just so enormous that the benefits, even when you break them down, are going to exceed the costs. Now, in terms of your question was how, do we see commonalities between the three of our approaches? I mean, I think Eric's project, which I'm just hearing about for the first time, which sounds really fascinating, is necessarily going to get at the other side of some of those questions, I think, right? Sort of the political and legal differences, and also natural resource endowments and things like that, that are cased or placed to place. And he may see, his project may be more responsive to your intuition, which is that these regional differences matter than the question of whether we ought to shut down coal-fired power plants.
Yeah, I mean, just building on that, I think even the challenge, I think, is even in regions where the aggregate benefits exceed the aggregate costs, the problem is how that's distributed within the region. So, this is the public choice story you could tell, which is that the air benefits are broadly distributed among a community, but the cost of the regulation will fall on disproportionately on particular elements of that community. So I think the public choice dynamic problems are going to be pretty present. And to frame our project in public choice terms, and those of you familiar sort of James Q. Wilson's work, what we're trying to do is change that dynamic where there's concentrated beneficiaries from the regulation as well. And as I indicated in my presentation, that has risks. One, what you do in this sector has impacts in other sectors, so David's point about distributional impacts matter. And it also has risks that you'll just screw things up. You're picking winners and losers, which economists hate. Our point is, if you don't do that, you'll never get to a point where you get a good policy, or at least it's much harder, and we don't have that much time. But you could pick wrong. And so are there ways to reduce that risk? And that's something I think we're gonna really struggle with. Are there ways to figure that out?
The point about co-benefits is simply enormous in this conversation, and figuring out in particular jurisdictions how to create co-benefits is one way of, and I think Eric's work sort of points toward that, is one way of enabling sort of the ball to move forward. The other thing that I would say, and I'm channeling a colleague at my law school, whose claim has been consistently for quite some time that understanding this thing in terms of macroeconomics and utility is all wrong, that we really need to think about this harder in terms of the moral and ethical consequences of where we're going. And his argument is, and I think there's something to this, is that if you want to generate a social movement around this, that social movement has to have some component in it of what does all of this mean for future generations and for the kinds of distributive issues that we're talking about.
Okay, we are out of time, but really, really interesting stuff. Please join me in thanking our panelists.